Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Dunwoody. We're so glad you're here with us. My name's Aaron Hale. I'm the worship leader here, and this is the band. And we're glad you're here. Why don't you stand and join us as we worship this morning?
You see my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night, oh God, battle belongs to you.
And if you are for me, who can be against me?
And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible. Plans Your ways are not my ways. You don't need me to build a temple to know that you love me still.
Like Israel.
Like Israel on the shore. All I see are crashing waves. Like Israel on the shore. Through the wild you make a way. I will go where you go. I will stay where you stay.
Oh. Sing, I don't want to go if you're not going.
Cause I don't want to go if you're not going before me. I don't want to go if you're not going before me. I don't want to go if you're not going before me. I don't want to go if you're not going before me.
Like Moses.
Like Moses in the desert, I want to see the land. Like Moses in the desert, I can't fully see your plan. Still your love doesn't stop when I see the land from the mountaintop. Oh.
Like Peter on the hill.
Like Peter on the hill, I want to make. I will go where you go. I will stay where you stay.
Oh, I don't want to go.
Cause I don't want to go if you're not going before me. I don't want to go if you're not going before me.
Maybe seated. Well, Happy New Year. All right, we need a little more energy to start the year off. Let's try that again. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
There we go. That's the energy I like to feel at 9 o'clock. Well, I'm Garrett Wallace, one of the pastors here, and we're so glad that you have decided to join us this morning in worship, as for many of, some of us were here last week, but for many of us, we begin the year off this week on this Epiphany Sunday. So I have a question for you. How are your New Year's resolutions going? Has anybody already failed, like me? I decided I wanted to read more this year because after seminary, I just took a break from reading. I was tired of reading things, got sick and didn't want to do it anymore, and so I didn't read a lot. So I'm trying to get back into the habit of learning intentionally and reading more, and I haven't been doing a very good job. But I'm also trying to create new habits, right? That's part of why I'm trying to read more and to pay more attention to where God is leading me in this new year. Because that's part of what our New Year's resolutions are about, right? Creating new habits, trying to make ourselves better, improve our lives. And sometimes we do a good job at following those things, and sometimes we don't. So this morning, as we go through worship, I would invite you not to just think about the habits that you want to have in the new year, new routines that you want to create, but actually where God is leading you in this year. Things that might make you uncomfortable, maybe to places where you don't really want to go. But reflect on that, ponder that this morning as we go through worship. I'd like to invite you now to stand and greet your neighbor with the love and peace of Christ.
As we continue in worship, hear these words from Psalm 108. My heart is steadfast, O God. I will sing and make melody with all my being. I will awake the dawn. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, among the peoples. I will sing praises to you among the nations, for your steadfast love is great above the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the clouds. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Let's worship together.
When the music fades and all is stripped away,
won't you stand and join me?
And I simply come, longing just to breathe something that's a worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart.
I'm coming back.
I'm coming back to the heart of worship. And it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made. When it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
King of endless word.
King of endless word. No one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours. Every single breath,
I'll bring you more than a song.
I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart.
Coming back.
I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made. When it's all about you, it's all about you. All about you, all about you, Jesus. I'll bring you more than a song. I'll bring you more than a song. It's all about you.
Let's sing that together. I'll bring you more.
I'll bring you more than a song. I'll bring you more than a song. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we worship you in the beauty of your holiness, and we bow down before you in reverent praise, for you alone are worthy to receive all honor and glory and praise and blessing and worship. You are our God, and your name is great in all the earth. You spoke the worlds into being, and you stretched out the heavens by the might of your great power. You've established your strength from everlasting to everlasting, and the heavens are the work of your fingers. And Lord, we are your people, the sheep of your pasture, and you are our God, and we worship you. God, this morning as we worship, we also want to lift up those in our community who are hurting and who are grieving. And we ask that you remind them of your love and you bring them comfort right now. Remind them of your strength and your power. Lord, we lift up Mindy Zatto and her family on the death of her father, Joe, as well as Reverend Jenna and Patrick Kennedy on the death of Jenna's father, David Mobley. And Lord, we also lift up John Reed and his family on the death of his wife, Catherine. Lord, bring peace and comfort in their time of mourning. Lord, we also celebrate with all those who are celebrating in our community as well. We thank you so much for your blessings. Lord God, you looked down in mercy and grace on us, and you sent the eternal Son of your love to visit us and redeem us. We rejoice in your gracious love and your great compassion, and we find joy in you, the God of our salvation. We sing your praises forever, and we worship you with our lives, for you alone are worthy to be praised and worshiped. We thank you, Lord, for loving us and sending us your Son, Jesus, in whose name we pray all these things by lifting up the prayer he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's sing that chorus one more time together. I'm coming back.
I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
Amen. You guys can be seated.
Good morning, friends. It is great to be back with you. I cannot believe that I avoided COVID for 2.5 years, and the day before our Christmas Eve service, I come down with it and test positive for 10 days. What an amazing thing. Anybody else with me? Anybody been on this journey at one level or another? It is great to be here with you and to be able to share with you. One of the bonuses, though, that I did have was I was able to watch the Steelers play on Christmas Eve on my TV while I had the Christmas Eve services up on my laptop. So I was able to do double duty that way. And we have the installation of our new bishop today, Bishop Robin Deese. She's going to be installed at 4 o'clock at Oak Grove today, and we're blessed that she's going to be our new leader. And one of the people that works with her, Brian Tillman. Where are you, Brian? Brian's standing in the back. He's the director of inclusion and advocacy for our annual conference. He's a friend of mine. He's going to be teaching one of our Sunday school classes today. And we're glad he's with us. And Brian, do you think she would take it well if I told her that her installation conflicts with the Steelers game this week? Maybe I shouldn't say that. But, friends, with what happened in the NFL this week, we're reminded that games are important until they're not. Games are important until someone gets hurt and or someone's life is at stake. And my prayers and our prayers go out to all those who are hurting, who are feeling pain and struggling with loss this day. Our prayers go to Damar Hamlin and his family. They go for the Bills and the Bengals. They go for every parent who allows their child out on the field of play, risking injury at any time. Our prayers today go to those who are hurting and those who are struggling and those who are in pain. Aaron shared with you some of the losses in the life of our church this week. I also want to lift up our wonderful and amazing youth minister, Jessica Ferguson, who lost her mom unexpectedly this week. So please keep her in your prayers. It is difficult to be in such a season of hope and such a season of loss at the same time. I'm thankful for the witness of Ole Miss. You don't say that a lot, but I'm thankful for the witness of Ole Miss, who was playing Texas Tech in the Tax Act, I can't even say it, the Tax Act Texas Bowl over the holidays. And while they were playing, Texas Tech lined up in one of their former coaches, Mike Leach's favorite air raid formations, and then took a delay of game penalty. And in kindness and in solidarity, Ole Miss then would not take the penalty. They refused to take the penalty. The same thing happened in the Mississippi State game. And Mississippi State lined up in the same formation, and then Illinois declined the penalty. And it created a moment of silence. It created a moment of silence to remember Mike Leach and the impact he had on the game. They said about Mike that our sport was better because of Mike Leach and is far less interesting without him. Games are important, friends, even you Bulldog fans. Games are important until they're not. And so I ask you to take a moment of silence with me as we delay our game here today and listen to what God has to say to us. Take a moment of silence to lift up your hurt, your pain, and the sorrow of others in your life. Let us just take a moment of silence together now. Gracious God, start here with us. Start here, search us and know us. Know our hurts, our struggles, and our sorrows, and help us to lean more fully into you for the new year. We lift up ourselves, we lift up others, we lift up all those who are in pain and sorrow. May you be with us and with them. In your name we pray. Amen. Friends, games are important until they're not. One parent said to me, games are fun until they're not. You know, the kids do pretty well and then someone gets to crying or gets hurt. And the game was great fun until it stops being fun anymore. In our scripture text today, we follow the Magi. The Magi have looked into the stars. They've looked into the sky. And although these were people who would not have been included in the Hebrew understanding of the people of God, they saw that God was at work. They saw that God was up to something by studying the night sky, and they searched diligently for what God was up to. They wanted to know what God was doing in the world, and I love the way God does that. The way God includes people we might not include. The way God shows God's self and reveals God's self to people who would have been thought of as foreigners, outsiders, and perhaps heathens, and they respond to what they see God doing in the world. I think we've always been fascinated by the night sky since the very beginning of humanity, looking up and taking in the stars that are above us. I love the story of the two little boys in upstate New York. They were looking up at the night sky, and one looked at the other and said, "What do you think's further away, the moon or Florida?" And the other one said, "Isn't that obvious? You can see the moon from here. You can't see Florida." We've been fascinated since we were children, and we say things like this: starlight, star bright, first star I see tonight. I wish tonight. We love the night sky, and something is going to happen like that star of Bethlehem coming up, a once-in-a-lifetime occurrence. You're going to be able to see a comet with the naked eye on February 1st, and it's going to streak past Camelopardalis. How many of y'all are familiar with Camelopardalis? I didn't know anything about it, so I called one of our resident experts, the Dr. Stanton Stebbins, and I called Stanton and I said, "You got to tell me a little bit about Camelopardalis." And he said, "Oh, Phil," and he sent me a picture from his phone, okay? Here's Camelopardalis, and above Camelopardalis is what he has been studying with his telescope, a constellation called Heart and Soul. And he wanted to make sure that I understood that Camelopardalis is camel and spotted camel, or the giraffe constellation in Latin. Anybody knew that besides Stanton? Okay, I just wanted to make sure that it's good to have a resident expert. And he said, "I've been taking pictures of Heart and Soul," and he said, "Let me send them to you." And this is the picture that he got with his telescope. What a beautiful thing of the Heart constellation. This is Heart and Soul. I don't know if you got the, that's Heart. Isn't that beautiful? And then Heart and Soul together is the other one. Heart and Soul. Doesn't the little one look like a baby? I mean, isn't that incredible? God speaking to us through nature, through the created order, if we would just pay attention. I'm thankful for the Magi who looked at the stars and saw that God was up to something. As we hear the good news today from those stargazers in the second chapter of Matthew, hear these words. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the child who is born, the King of the Jews? Sir, we have observed his star at its rising, and we have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the ruler of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.' Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, 'Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage.'" When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. This is the good news according to Matthew. Thanks be to God. It is good news for us, but it wasn't good news for the Magi. They thought they were coming to share great good news with Herod. They thought this was a wonderful thing that they had seen this star in the sky, and they come to report to Herod to find the exact location. But Herod was known for playing games of the most destructive kind. He was playing games with scripture. He was playing games with people's lives. They said that he was so manipulative and so mean that it was better to be a pig in his court than to be one of his own sons. He was a person who lived and ruled by fear and was ruled by fear in his own life. He was fueled by fear and fueled fear in others. It says that when he heard this, he was afraid and all Jerusalem with him. And I believe that when rulers and leaders lead with fear, that fear just ripples into the rest of those that they lead. That fear doesn't just stay with the leader. That fear trickles out into everyone else. And in that fear, he asks his scribes to consult the scriptures. And he wants to use the scriptures to protect himself. He's not searching the scriptures to learn more about God. He's searching the scriptures to figure out how he can quell this threat of a newborn king. Can you imagine anyone being undone by a newborn baby? I had twins. I can. It can be a difficult thing. But he came completely undone because of a threat from many years later. And so he misuses people and manipulates people to try and get his own way. He misuses scripture and manipulates scripture to try and figure out how he can, quote unquote, pay this child homage. He's playing games of the most insidious kind. But the Magi are not there to play games. They are there to offer their gifts. They're there to discover this new thing that God is doing. And in the book of Isaiah, we're told that about the camels that will be there. And then we're told that they will come and open their gifts of gold and frankincense. And I imagine them getting there to the house. It's no longer a manger, and Joseph isn't anywhere to be seen, but Mary and the baby are there, and they come into the house, and they offer the gifts that Isaiah has prophesied of gold and frankincense. And I'm thinking there's one Magi that just kind of stood in the back, and they let the other two give the gold and frankincense. And the third Magi, he must have been a dad, he jumped out and said, "But wait, there's myrrh." It does make you wonder, though. It does make you wonder why myrrh is included as the third gift. Because it's not in Isaiah. It's not part of the prophecy. And so it helps to read the rest of the story. If you read further along in the book of Mark, you will find that on the cross, Jesus is offered a mixture of wine and myrrh. And then when Joseph of Arimathea comes to wrap the body, he wraps it in aloe and myrrh. So it might be a bit of foreshadowing to say that these are wonderful gifts, these tangible gifts of gold, frankincense, but myrrh is foreshadowing perhaps the kind of death that Jesus is to die. We're thankful for those tangible gifts that Jesus received, but I'd like to posit that there are four gifts of the Magi that we can still receive today, that they offer four gifts to us today. And the first gift is the gift of searching the natural order to see what God has up to. Have you spent any time just pondering the gifts of creation lately? Just looking at the night sky, looking at the beauty of the creation that God has made for all of us and allowed us to live and to be stewards of it. It is a beautiful thing. They search, and searching is a great place to start your new year. Now, I don't know what your search history was like from last year. Maybe you want to share it with all of us, but our search histories may not have always spent time searching for what God is up to in the world. In fact, I did some research to see what kind of things people had been searching for, and these are some of the things that were the top searches. Wordle, rupee, and oligarch. Anybody? Okay. How to pronounce? Qatar, Qatar, right? How to help Ukraine. I think that was a worthy search. Gas prices near me, at-home COVID tests near me, voting near me. Those were some of the top searches, and that really tells us a lot about the year that we've experienced. I wanted to look for the top food things that were searched, so I found these. Sugo, I had to Google that. I've added to the searches now because I didn't know what sugo is. How many of y'all know sugo? Okay, the rest of you are going to Google that probably right now. Cincinnati chili, can I get a witness? All right. Okay, five ways. Marry me chicken. This is chicken that is so good if you make it for someone, they supposedly want to marry you. Quick pancakes in this fast world that we're in, and mango pie. I have yet to figure out what that is, but maybe someday I will figure out what mango pie is. We are a people who are addicted to searching, but are we searching for the right things? Are we searching to be changed? Check out what people are searching for this year. This year, more than ever, the world searched.
Even though it's a risk and I don't know what's on the other side, I'm gonna make a bet on myself.
I guess I'm kind of looking at this as a sort of rebirth opportunity.
I just quit my job and flew to Scotland with no money or plans or friends.
This is day one of me exercising every day.
I've really gone and done it now.
It's a bonus farm.
Turned in my 2-week notice. I just took the leap.
Yeah, I'm really liking how my hair's been going.
I feel like we're on the verge of a renaissance.
They say to do what you love, and I love to dance.
Oh my God! I'm following you!
I can't imagine a more beautiful thing.
Can anybody imagine a more beautiful thing than corn? It's a gift that keeps on giving over and over and over again. But what we are searching for tells us a lot about who we are and who we're striving to be. And the Magi were searching for what God was up to in the world. And when they actually find that the star has stopped, they get OJ, not a Bills player, but overwhelming joy. Overwhelming joy is what they receive when they finally find what they're looking for. When they find God's presence and when God's presence finds them, the gift of overwhelming joy is there. And after that gift of overwhelming joy, they come and they kneel down before the child. Have you spent any time kneeling this new year? Maybe you knelt for communion last week when I wasn't here. Maybe you knelt by your bedside and said some prayers asking God to guide your searches this new year. I hope you'll spend some time kneeling this week. Kneeling at the altar rail, kneeling at your bedside, kneeling somewhere. It's a humbling position if you've never taken that posture. And taking that posture and say, God, I don't know exactly where I'm going this year, but I need you to direct me and guide me. So kneeling in that humble posture may be something you want to consider. You may even want to make your seat a place to kneel as we play our closing hymn today and people go and get their star words. I always love the way Betsy Ross made her stars. She did it with just one cut. Adam, you want to come and get your star here? Open it up. Just one cut. We have star words for you to get during our closing song. You can go over and get them. You'll pick one up. And if you want to find a place in the corner or back at your chair to kneel and to say, God, how can this word guide me? How can I follow your star more closely into the new year? The gifts of the Magi are searching the creation for what God is doing. The gifts of the Magi are willingness to kneel and to open themselves. They open themselves and they open their gifts before God, offering those tangible gifts of gold, frankincense and myrrh. And we can be changed when we open ourselves and open our gifts to God. I know some of us have places in our lives that have been closed to Christ. And perhaps one of your resolutions to the new year is to open that part of yourself and let Christ do something new in and through you. For these are tremendous gifts. I'm thankful for some of you who opened the bags that we gave you on Christmas Eve and filled them with canned goods and with food for people who are hungry, for the way you're opening yourself and offering yourself to others. I'm so thankful for the people who came by and brought me soup or a word of care. You got me through 10 very difficult days along with Elizabeth's TLC, and somehow she never got it. I am so grateful for that gift. Being open and willing to offer our gifts is a wonderful thing. I told you about King Herod. The second king I want to talk to you about was born on this day, January the 8th, 1935. And on his 11th birthday, he went with his mother to the Tupelo hardware store, and he had a specific gift in mind. And I'm told that they stood in the hardware store, and some people say that they argued, but the official Elvis fan club says they didn't argue. He just said, "Yes, ma'am, whatever you want to give me is fine." And there is an X on the floor there in the Tupelo hardware store where the two of them stood, and he asked her for a 22. He wanted a 22 for his 11th birthday, and they may have argued, and instead of buying him a rifle, she bought him an axe. She bought him, with $7.90, his first guitar. It wasn't the gift he wanted, but it was the gift that he needed, and the rest is history. And you may not know this, but he was born a twin. He was Elvis Aaron, and his twin was Jesse Garon. And Jesse never took a breath, but there were times in Elvis's life when he would look up in the night sky and he would think of a star as his brother Jesse looking down on him, and it gave him encouragement and strength as he thought of his brother Jesse as one of the stars in the night sky. I love what Elvis said. He said, "The Lord gave us music to bring people together. All I want to know is the truth, to know and experience God. I'm a searcher. That's what I'm all about." A wonderful gift that he didn't even know he wanted that changed his life. I wonder what it would be like for us to give a gift to someone that they didn't even know they wanted or needed, that could change their life. The third king I want to talk about is a fellow who was born on this day. And when he was 21 years old, while he was at Cambridge University, he was told that he had ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease. Stephen J. Hawking. See what I did there? Stephen J. Hawking. He, at 21, was told that basically his life was over. And he said, "At 21 years old, I had no expectation, and everything since that moment was a bonus." He lived longer than anyone else with ALS, 55 years. And on his 70th birthday, he said these things, which I thought were amazing. He said, "Remember to look up at the stars and not down at your feet. Number two, never give up work. Work gives you meaning and purpose, and life is empty without it. That doesn't mean you shouldn't retire, but you should still also have something meaningful to do with your life and with your ministry. You should do something like work on our Night to Shine. We have over 100 participants coming to Night to Shine. I'm told we have 214 people signed up, and we need about 40 more to make the 10th of February successful. Maybe you need a Night to Shine yourself, and you want to get to work in doing something meaningful like that." And finally, he said, "If you're lucky enough to find love, remember it is there and don't throw it away." And then he went on to talk about creation, and he said, "Be curious, and however difficult life may seem, there's always something you can do and succeed at it. It matters that you just don't just give up." The Magi also did not give up. They were curious about what God was up to. They looked up to the stars and didn't look down at their feet to find what God was doing, to find what God was up to. So I love these gifts of the Magi, the gift of searching, the gift of searching God's creation, the gift of being willing to kneel down before God and ask God for guidance, and finally a willingness to open ourselves and our gifts for God's purposes. even if it's a gift you're not sure you want to give or need to give. And then the last thing, they're told they're supposed to go back to Herod and report back to him about where the child was so he can hunt down this child. I think it was James Taylor who said it this way: stay clear of royal welcomes, avoid the big to-do. A king who will slaughter innocents won't cut a deal for you. And so they are warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, and they're told to go home by another way, home by another road. And that is the last gift they give us. Because in order to start new habits in the new year, we need to break some of the patterns from the old year. They go home a different way. They go home by a different route. Charles Duhigg, in his wonderful book, The Power of Habit, if you're looking for a great read for the new year, Garrett, I would like to recommend it. But it talks about how you can't change your habit until you change the cues that lead to that habit. And he tells the story of a woman who was struggling with alcohol, and she would leave work and stop at the same liquor store day after day, week after week. And it wasn't until she started going home by a different way that she was able to change her life and begin to deal with her addictive behavior. Maybe today you'll go home by a different way. Take a different staircase out of the church. Go out differently. May you be changed and transformed because you decided to go home by a different way and to look more closely at what God was doing and what God is up to in this wonderful world of ours. Friends, games are important until they're not. And I know some of you have got to be tired of some of the games you've been playing with yourself. And maybe it's time to move from those games into God's giftedness for you. For gifts are incredibly important, especially ones you don't know that you wanted or you needed. The Magi received wonderful gifts and shared gifts of good news. Elvis's guitar was a gift that changed his life and changed the world. May we give such gifts by the way that we live in this world. Because with the grace and love of God, there is always myrrh. There is always myrrh to be done. There is always myrrh to receive. And I hope that you'll prayerfully receive your star word this day, and it might be a guide for you. Mine that I kept above my desk all year was leadership. And I've tried my best to live into that gift, even in the most difficult of days and decisions. May this word help guide you to what you're searching for as you search more diligently for God in the days ahead. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for this time together, for the way that you work in and through us, and for these star words that will guide us into the new year. Help us to live in your light, the light of your star to guide us. May we be pulled out of whatever darkness we find in ourselves as we search more diligently for you. We give you thanks for your many gifts. May we make the most of them. In your name we pray. Amen.
Friends, as we respond to the word of God this morning, I'd like to invite you, as Phil mentioned, to go to one of the counters on either side of this space and pick up your star word. If you need help figuring out where to start looking for God in your life, that is an easy way to focus your attention and see what God is doing in your life. But we also have several ways for you to respond to the word this morning. You can also give financially by scanning the QR code on the screen or on the back of your bulletin, or by dropping your offering in the basket when the ushers come forward in a few moments during our closing song. But friends, your giving makes a difference. Did you know that we collected over $33,000 on Christmas Eve this year? 100% of which will be spent outside the walls of this church as we go to the broken places in our community and try to make the world a little bit more like the kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven. So your giving makes a huge difference. Also, inside the walls of this church, in a few weeks, on January 22nd, we're going to give all of our third graders their very own Bible, one that's age-appropriate for them, so they can begin to take ownership of their own faith, to do their own study, their own reading, to connect with God in their own way. If you have a third grader that's not signed up yet, there's still time, so get with Tambrin and get your child on the list. But your giving makes such a difference inside the walls of this church and also outside the walls in the community and the world. As the band plays our final song and the ushers come forward, let us return to God a portion of what has been given to us.
Thank you.
It's good to know what wise men say. We have a couple of folks who are joining the church today. One family is sick. There's still some sickness going around. I'd like to invite the Olsons and the Buells to come forward, if you will. And if you come to the center here, people can see you. I know there are a lot of y'all, so if you'll please come to the center. We're here to welcome Eric and Emily Olson. He's an attorney, and she's a pediatric neuropsychologist. I get that right. They have a Bailey is at UGA. Is not here, sophomore at UGA. Caroline is a senior at Riverwood High School, and her two choices are TCU and UGA. I wonder what relevance that has. So does it depend on who wins? okay? And they have Gemma, who likes to dance, and Oliver, who likes to laugh at Gemma. So they are blessed as a family. And who else is with us?
This is my mom, Barbara.
We're so glad to have you with us. Welcome, welcome. And then the Buell family over here. We have Colby, who's a graduate of UGA. He'll be glad to talk you into where you need to go. He works at Truck IT or Truck It. Truck It LLC. They were married at Peachy Road back in April of 2012. Laura has two older brothers. Some of you might know them, Brian and Brad Beard. Anybody know those guys? Okay, so don't hold that against her. She's a graduate of University of Alabama, has worked as a CFP for 15 years, was a third-generation member at Peachy Road, and is currently a stay-at-home mom. They have four kids. Cash, how many we have here? We have three? There's one. Okay. I was going to say, Cash, who is nine, who's at Austin and loves all sports, especially baseball, football, and soccer. Major and Bishop, who are five and in kindergarten at Austin Elementary. You know what it means to be undone by having two at the same time. They both play baseball, basketball, and soccer. And Billy is in the threes class here. She's hiding down there at DUMC preschool. She loves ballet, soccer, and basketball. We are blessed to have you as the newest members of the Dunwoody United Methodist Church. And I'm going to ask you the questions of the kings. Are you willing to search for Jesus more diligently in your lives?
Yes.
All right. Are you willing to kneel before God and ask God for direction? And are you willing to open and offer your gifts through this church back to God? And finally, will you live out your faith through this church, through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? We welcome you as the newest members of the Dunwoody United Methodist Church. We know you will be a blessing to us, and we hope to be a blessing to all of you. You guys want to stand up on stage so people can see you? Would you like to be up there with me? Maybe? Maybe not? Come on. Come on. Okay. Welcome. We're glad to have you all with us. Welcome. Welcome. Glad to have you with us. And who's praying for her to go to UGA? Who's praying for her to go to TCU? There's one. There's one. So you can talk to them back there. And we're glad to have you with us too. Welcome, Barbara. The TCU fan is doing something that the rest of you are not. It looks like her significant other is headed with 10 other people to Florida this week to do hurricane relief. And so we want to be in prayer for you. We thank you. So while the UGA fans are staying home to cheer, the TCU fans are going out in mission. So I just want to be clear about that. Friends, as you leave today, there's a Start Here bookmark for your year, and it has the Wesley Covenant Prayer that Calissa preached about last week. I hope that you'll grab one of those so that you can continue your searching faithfully. So now go and be like Elvis, for Elvis has left the building. May we leave this place and go forth to be in ministry to all the world in new and creative ways, because wise men say that fools rush into some places like TCU or UGA, depending on how it goes. But we can't help falling in love with the God who loves us so much. I'll ask them to follow me out today, and I'll invite you to stand as we sing our closing benediction song. Go in peace and not to pieces, my friends.
Oh, Holy Ghost, hold us together, bless us and keep us, and grant us peace. Wonderful Father, come shine upon us, show us favor and teach us love. Peace. wonderful Father, come shine upon us. Show us favor in Jesus' name.
Amen. Go in peace. Have a great week. We'll see you next week.